Python contains two parallel frameworks. One is the web framework and the other is the Python native framework. I'm working on the Python native framework, and this session will be on the Python native framework. Underlying, we have something called Core as well. The Core, which, if you remember, Sanjay was talking about Core C APIs in the morning, and he was talking about this particular Core API. The difference between the framework which is on top and the Core is that the framework's motto or the agenda is to maintain ABC application library compatibility, whereas no such promise is done by the Core. So that's the difference. And you can see on top of the framework you have the Tizen public APIs. What exactly is Tizen native framework and what it supports? The Tizen native framework supports C++ APIs. There are abundant C++ APIs that's available to developers, more than 10,000 APIs are available. Along with the APIs, it provides all the standard C++ and C libraries. And it also provides, apart from the standard libraries, it also provides OpenGL ES for OpenGL development, then OpenAL for the audio library, OpenMP for multi-processing, multi-programming concepts, and libxml2. So these are a few of the libraries which are provided apart from the standard libraries. The native framework also has package installation, uninstallation, and upgrade. Totally, package management is taken care by the native framework. Here, what we mean by package is it's a zipped file of your binaries and the data. Then it manages all the application lifecycle. Then the application goes through different states from initialization, running, foreground, background, to termination. So this management is done by the native framework. And then we have system event handlers for applications. Sometimes the application will want to show some critical pop-ups or critical information to the user, like the battery management or power management, the memory information. So the event handlers are given to the application from the native side. As you can see, that the native framework has many modules, such as app, graphics, UI, base, I/O, security, etc. In the coming slides, I've just picked up a few important modules and just give an overview of the modules. The first most important module is the base. Base is more like a foundation in here. The base gives all the basic data types and the collection classes, all your array maps, hash maps, then array list, your linked list, etc. Stack, etc. is given by the collection classes here in the base. Then we have I/O, which deals with all the file system operations, create, delete, all the file management basically, as well as the database management. And we have text, which deals with encoding and conversion of text. At the moment it supports GSM, UCS2, then UDF8, and ASCII. Then we have something called LLVM concept in base. What exactly is LLVM is, if a developer, you know, right now there are two processes which are supported by Tizen, that is x86 and ARM. So developer need not have multiple applications for multiple processes. So all he has to do is just develop his application, put it on the store, and the infrastructure will take care of building the right binary for the right processor. So that's LLVM, basically the client is what is supported. And it also supports OpenMP, which is nothing but the multi-processing support. Right now, these days we don't deal with just one processor, there are quad cores which have come up. So they all use shared memory. So OpenMP harnesses the advantage of using multi-core processors here. So you can develop your application for multi-programming. So this is about base. Application framework, if base is a foundation, application framework is more like the heart of the system, where it manages all the lifecycle management. I have another slide which shows the lifecycle management. I'll explain more on that. It deals with event handling and UI and service application. In Tizen, we have two different modes of application. One is the UI application and the other is the service application. UI is, of course, as the name indicates, it's a face application. It has a face, it has a UI. whereas a service application is more like something which runs in the background, which doesn't have a UI as such. The UI application can be opened or run by clicking on the icon, or it can be clicked from the tree or something like that. But service application can be run from the boot, or some other application can run the service application. So there are basically two modes of application. Then the package management. As I explained, TPK is the packet, which is nothing but the zip version of your binary and the data. You have similar package management system for the web applications as well, and the extension for web applications are WDT. Inter-application communication is also managed by application framework. Here, two applications can communicate with each other, that's inter-application communication. There are basically three modes in which application can communicate. One is the app control, the other is data control, and third one would be through message boards. Now, for example, you're browsing a web page, and in your browser, you have a telephone number somewhere on top, or an email ID or something. So you click on that, the dialer or the message application will be open. How did the browser get to know what application to open? This is nothing but inter-application communication. Browser makes use of the exported features of the other application. So such inter-application communication is managed by the application framework. Then graphics and media, we have for 2D drawing, we have something called 2D canvas. For 3D graphics, we have something called OpenGL, it supports OpenGL 1.1 and 2.0. We have a few other concepts such as canvas texture and video texture as well. The canvas texture is nothing but we have an OpenGL texture on which we associate a canvas and then make use of all the graphics APIs to draw on it. This actually gives a 3D simulation of your application. So, 2D canvas and OpenGL for 2D and 3D, basically. And then we have media playback and recording, image audio, video coding, ECM audio input and output. That is uncompressed audio. And we have OpenAL. OpenAL is for application which would want to make use of 3D sound. This would place the source of the image in 3 dimensions. Then user interface, there are many UI controls which are available. Tab, you have text box, X box, then you have list box, there are list items. There are various UI controls which are available. Then scalability is nothing but you don't have to, if you don't have to maintain different applications for different resolutions. Tizen, there are tools available in Tizen which will take care of how to handle multiple resolution. The concept which is used is here is something called logical coordinate system, wherein you give the logical coordinate. For example, you have given 480 as your logical coordinate, and you build your binary and you flash on the device, but the device is a HD device and supports 720 as its resolution. Automatically, the Tizen platform itself takes care of mapping your logical coordinate to the physical coordinate. That is 480 will be scaled up to 720. It can scale down, so vice versa. Animations, web, app controls. Web is nothing but web control is an embedded browser. You can call it as an embedded browser. Say, for example, you are developing a contact application and you want to show some web content in that contact application. All you have to do is just pick web control, put it in your application, and then feed the HTML input. HTML data, the web control, which is locally put in your application. So that's about web control. Then we have 3D effect and authoring tool. So you can create 3D effect using 3D tool. Then you have UI extensions, which are nothing but sensors, motion, face, and speech. Basically, sensors are nothing but they have. You can develop games by making use of the sensors which are available. Accelerometer, then gravity, proximity sensors. So you have various sensors using which you can develop games, game-like applications. Then you have motion, that is, you can have your own features for motion tap, double tap or swipe or something. Then you have face recognition and link recognition, and text-to-speech and speech-to-text. In communication, we have it supports Bluetooth, three major profiles are supported, AIP, SPP, and OPP. Then you have sockets, which are the low-level communication medium. It supports TCP, UDP. Then it also supports your center sockets, HTTP 1.0, 1.1, then Wi-Fi, Wi-Fi Direct, and group management. NFC is also supported, and the standard SMS, email, and MMS application service is supported. You also have IP push and telephony. If an application wants to make use of IP push, it has to first register to the IP server. We have something called IP client, which is more from a service which is running in the background. So you register your application to this, and it maintains a public connection between your application and the server. So whenever you are connected, the server pushes the data over IP to your application. If not, it will send a notification which you can download later. So the next is social content and location. We have third-party SMS integration, using which you can develop mashups. Content search, you can search content on your device. What we mean by content here is it is just a logical representation of data. Data could be image, video, or audio. A file, a content has two things. One is the physical file, and the other is the metadata associated with it. So we have database where the metadata will be stored and it will be linked to the file. So content management could be easier. Then you have maps, geocoding, and location triggering. So geocoding and reverse geocoding are supported, where you will give the name of the place as a string, and you can get the coordinates, and the reverse is supported. In application purchasing is supported. So this was about the framework features. Introduction to SDK, most of the slides and most of the features are already covered by Lakshmi. So I'll just give a brief idea of the native application development features. So this is how the Eclipse IDE looks. You have the project explorer, editor area, and event injector. Then the problem and console window. This is how you create a project for web app. Of course, you will be using native web app project. For native apps, you will be using native app. And on the left hand side, you have a template and a sample tab. You click on sample tab, you get about 65 to 70 sample applications, using which the learning curve will be easier. Emulator, this is based on the open source QMO project. It is a virtual device emulator, and it has its own virtual CPU and memory. On the right hand side, you can see the file system, and the communication between you and the emulator would be through the SDB commands, Smart Development Bridge commands. Here is the emulator manager. Advantage of this, or the main goal of emulator manager, is you can create multiple emulators, multiple images for various configurations. You can have different configurations such as different RAM sites, display, and you can maintain multiple images. So this is how you create, add new, then just put in your configurations, give a name to it, and then you can start running the instance. Artificial events can be generated using the event injector. This would be useful if you are developing games. Basically, if you want to experience the tilt, if you don't have a device and you want to take decisions based on the tilt of the device, you can use the event injector. It supports device location, NFC, sensors, and everything. Documentation is available. You can find documentation. This also gives you samples, as in it has a few samples in it, and it has a few explanations on why such APIs can be and how you can use it. So it has textual information as well. And I was talking about the sample apps. There are about 65 to 70 sample apps which you can use. The learning curve will definitely be shorter, as in you can get used to how the API is used and all using these kind of apps. Okay, what you see is what you get tool is available. Of course, you can develop your applications programmatically also, but that would be a tedious task. If you want visualization of the application that you're developing, you can use this tool. All you have to do is just drag and drop. For example, here we have shown a button, and you can change the properties using this tool. You can also set event handlers to the button from here. The form information will be stored as XML. This is a plugin. This is not for Eclipse. It's customized. Then you have string resource localization. Localization is nothing but the for internationalization basically, and you just have to give one string and different languages. So based on the settings of your device or emulator, the right strings will be picked up, and the normal debugging and tracing operations. Dynamic analyzer is one useful tool if you want to profile your applications, or if you want to check the performance of your application, you can use the dynamic analyzer. On the left hand side, you can see that this gives you information of how much CPU you are using, or how much heat allocation memory you are using. And on the right hand side, you can see the call trace as well, what are DPS will call. So this is one of the most important these were just the common tools, and specific to native would be the API and privilege checker. The API checker is nothing but, say, for example, I'm using SDK version 1.1 and I'm trying to use an API from 2.0. So there would be an alarm generated if such a thing is tried. Or if you're using a deprecated alarm, so if you're using a deprecated API, an alarm will be given. So while development, to make your development time, to reduce the development time, these tools can be used. And we spoke about privilege checker at length. Privilege is nothing but Tizen provides API level privileges. We have something called privilege checker. Basically, privileges comes in three types. One is public, the other is the platform, and the third is partner. So if any of your APIs are not properly mentioned in the manifest or config.xml, then alarm will be generated. And then we have UI builder and UI effect builder. UI effect builder, you can develop 3D effects for your application. And then Valgrind and Evergrind and Cavgrind are supported for your memory checks. So this was about the tools that's provided. Introduction to native app development at this brief through these slides. How to create a native app. File new Tizen native project, and you have templates on the left hand side. Empty application, form based application. If you are developing IME, you have an IME application. Then if you want a service application or OpenG application, you can choose the right one. Then here, this gives the folder structure and what the folders are meant for. Source and name for your source and data files, then resources. Resources could be audio, video, or your text, which your application can use. And then IDE libraries, if you're going to the lib folder, manifest.xml, your settings, basically. Then data, any read and writable files that your application uses or creates to go into data. There's something called shared folder. The shared folder, if your application wants to share information or data to other applications. You can assign privileges for user-sensitive data for your application. UI scalability, like I mentioned before, it works on the logical coordinate system. You can mention the coordinate system as logical and you can get the logical coordinate. Here it's given as 720. This doesn't mean that you have to use a HT target for this application, and for WVGA target you will have to have or maintain a different application. So the platform or the framework would map the logical coordinate system to the physical coordinate system. Then the declared features will be used for filtering on the store. So this is the how to build. Just right click on the project and build it, and you can run it as a native application. This is the application lifecycle. The launch for an app, a UI app, will be from the main menu. During the on-app initialization and initialize phase is where all the libraries and your application gets loaded onto the menu. Application can go to foreground and background. When it goes to the background, you have this opportunity to stop all the animations and resume when it comes to the foreground. During termination, you have an opportunity to delete or release all the memory which you have consumed. This is the basic UI structure. You have an indicator on top, you have a header and a footer, and the control which goes on, which needs to be added onto the container. A few sample UI controls: checkbox, table view, edit time, date. You have a list, then group buttons, etc. UI builder tool, which I've already covered. This is a drag and drop application. And this is how the idea from the school form.xml looks like. This is a layout manager. This comes handy when you are writing a UI for your application. Basically, there are four types of layouts: relative layout, vertical and horizontal layout, and grid layout. In relative layout, the position of your controls will be decided or will be relative to the controls which are already there on the form. You can always set up a relation between those controls. For example, I'd say align the left hand side of my control on the left hand side of all the controls which are available, something like that. You can always develop a relation. Then vertical and horizontal layout, as the name indicates, the controls are applying horizontally and vertically. You can always give more attributes such as margins, left, top, bottom margins. Then you can, there is another attribute called weight, what you want to do with the space surrounding the control. There are various other attributes, spacing, etc. In the grid layout, the controls are placed in a 2D matrix format. So that was about the layout, and here is the application development process. Install the SDK, create your project, use all the tools available while you code, then build. Testing can be done on your emulator or the target, then you can put it on the store. So this is about the development process. Python information is available at python.org, developer.python.org, and source.python.org and bugs.python.org. You can look up. So this was about the native framework. So if you have any questions.
So you have this drag and drop of UI components both with the web as well as in the native. Are there any differences in the look and feel of the two approaches?
One of the main idea behind this is the web application and the native application should be there should be difference between the web application and the native application. So usually this.
So some of the components that you showed for the native, like the sliders and the radio boxes, those are available for
you? Yes.
for any of the speakers from the day. So we have had a good series of sessions and a nice introduction to Tizen. I hope a lot of us will walk away with a good feel for what the ecosystem and platform is all about. And hopefully we'll see some activity around it. So a big thank you to all the speakers. And so we have lunch served right outside. Please go and have that. And the talks will resume at 2:30. Okay, so you have that. So thank you, everybody.